Vsauce, I'm Jake, and after watching the movie Arrival, I started thinking about time, but not linear time, which is what we generally experience, different concepts of time. So I decided to talk to an expert on the topic, Neil deGrasse Tyson, on variations of time.
Before relativity, our concept of time was that we're all participating in the same ticks of the clock. 1 second for you is 1 second for me. That's linear time. Linear means every interval is the same as every other interval, and one follows the next. Relativity, we learned that there is no such thing as absolute time. Time is relative. So time can be stretched for me relative to you. So time has multiple sort of parallel rates at which it flows, depending on the state of who's making the measurement and the state of who's in motion and what conditions they're in. Now think of time as a dimension. In our timeline, we are prisoners of the present, forever transitioning from our past into our future. So we don't know of access to other points in our own timeline. Suppose you could move around in your timeline with the same flexibility as moving left and right, up and down, forward and backward. If that's the case, then you can revisit your own timeline. Under those conditions, you do not die. You are always dying. You are not born. You are always being born. That's another kind of interesting way to think about time. So what we don't know, and this is a topic touched on in the movie Arrival, if you rejoin your life at a different point on the timeline, you have to ask, do you have the benefit of the knowledge acquired after that?
You can go from the future to the past, and maybe you have all the knowledge of everything because you've experienced it all. Mm-hmm. But if you go from the present to the future, would you experience everything that you would have had you stayed in that timeline?
That's a good question, because if your timeline is already existing, then you cannot change your fate. It's already writ. But suppose you had knowledge and could change it. Then you'd have to sort of pair off a whole other timeline, and it would become a very complex sort of fractal structure. What gets me about Terminator is he's got to kill everybody who might be the mother of the future of the person who overthrows the thing.
That's always the thing I thought, why didn't they go further back in time?
You can go further back and just have one little thing change and everything after that would change. Then it just wouldn't be as bloody.
Well, yeah,
boring.
It wouldn't be as fun.
Yeah.
But fun. If we talk about fun, yeah, all the bloody. No. But that actually brings up an interesting concept that, right, I think about a lot. I think about a lot when it comes to Terminator, which is the bootstrap paradox, where them going back in time is what starts the events happening in the first place.
Yes, yeah, so what happens is, so a gin particle is, they showed this in Somewhere in Time. Do you see it?
Nope, what is that?
Okay, because it was a chick flick. Okay, that's why.
Oh, and I wouldn't say, I don't look like the kind of guy who would watch a chick flick?
You're a comic book superhero guy with violence, okay?
But hey, violence isn't fun, remember that. It's not fun.
Okay, so it was a romantic love story. It had Christopher Reeve in it, actually. Some old woman comes to him, gives him some kind of a locket, and says, meet me back in time, or something, mm-hmm. Okay? And he's a young guy. So he figures out how to go back in time and meets her.
Oh, yeah.
And now they're the same age, and they have a love affair. And he gifts her this locket.
Yeah.
Okay? Now she has it. And gives it back to him. So this is called a gin particle in time travel. Okay, so this particle was never created.
Yes.
It was neither created nor destroyed. It only exists in this time loop.
Mm-hmm.
So it's counter to what we think should or shouldn't be in the physical world to which we've grown accustomed, of course.
Where did it come from? Like, did it just exist?
Yes, it just always existed. So with your Terminator loop,
yeah,
that his act of trying to change it sets the things in motion that makes it happen. Right.
Yep. And then it's never going to end. So that's the kind of thing that I have with the example you gave me with Terminator. Is it just one loop that'll never end?
Oh, you never come out of that loop.
You never come out of it.
Well, so in the case of Somewhere in Time, the gin particle stays forever in the loop, but the characters keep going. What you're saying is, in the Terminator, there were events that affected the whole world.
Mm-hmm.
So does the world emerge on the other side? I guess no, because it affected the whole world.
Yeah, because isn't this stuck in this loop?
Right, but if it was just some grandmother coming back to meet something, then that would be a very contained.
But what would we say then? So this is obviously speculative. Yeah. But if, so I'm Christopher Reeve, yeah. I go back in time.
Yes.
But does that mean everyone around me doesn't have to be the same? They could be different, or are they stuck in the same loop with me?
That wasn't addressed in the film.
It should have been. These are the questions I want to know.
These are the pressing questions. And so in the H.G. Wells Time Machine, mm-hmm. okay, they dealt with an interesting phenomenon that his love interest dies. She's mugged or something, mm-hmm. killed in the park. She says, well, I have a time machine, I can fix this. So he has her go somewhere else and not where the mugger was gonna be. And then she like get hits by a streetcar and dies. He does this multiple times. She dies every time. Mm. He concludes that certain events are just writ.
Yeah, are fixed points.
They're just fixed points. But I thought about it and I said, why should her death be any more of a significance than the fact that the mugger now mugs someone else? It's a changed event.
Because it changes then the timeline for all those people. The mugger's life is probably different. The person who's operating the car is now different.
Just so that you can kill off his love interest.
Yeah, kill this one person.
Yeah, just to make that one person die.
So it ripples. So actually the time machine is an interesting one because if I remember correctly, I haven't read in a while, but I always thought it was interesting how the time machine operates, where when he's in it, he sees everything moving quickly
yes,
past him.
Yes.
But I always imagine from the perspective of someone walking by, they're just looking at a man sitting like in a machine. I'm like, okay, that's boring.
No, it would be there in an instantaneous instant.
So he's actually moving through time. It's not things moving around him.
Correct. Okay. Correct. Right. So in some instance, so he's moving through, you would never even see it. Mm-hmm. I mean, it would happen so quickly. That's how I interpreted it.
Because I thought he was fixed in place. Like he's stuck on that point in Earth. So he's not moving.
So you're saying I'm here for 10 minutes and I don't budge, and so is the time machine.
Yeah, but so, from us in the time machine, time, because it's relative, it feels like we're going.
Oh, so they should have seen him.
Yes.
I'll give you that.
Because I always thought about time machines, I'm just gonna go to a different point in time. Like, well, the planet's gonna be somewhere entirely different. You're just gonna be in the middle of space.
But you give him that. He's also moving in space.
You
gotta give him that. Otherwise, you can't. When Marty goes back to 1985, he'd be...
Well, the DeLorean can counter that. It's the DeLorean. I mean, you know.
But if he goes back exactly 30 years, then Earth is back where it was in that moment, right? So, because if he goes back less than integral mm-hmm. number of years,
then he's out in space. Yeah.
So here's an interesting problem. Mm. So let's say tachyon communication exists. Mm. So I can send a signal backwards through time. And you're walking down the corridor and you slip and fall on a banana peel. You know, when I first saw people's, you know, cartoon characters slipping on banana peels, I said, first, why is a banana peel just there? And are banana peels really slippery? So I kept throwing banana peels on the ground and trying to slip on them. I never did. And then I had to realize you have to put the inside down.
The inside.
That has to face downward.
Oh, you were doing the outside.
Yeah, so it's not just slip on a banana, slip on the inner slippery surface.
Rookie mistake.
I know, complete rookie mistake. So then I did that, it was like, whoa, that is really slippery. Mm-hmm. But if you toss a banana peel, it's not gonna just open up and land octopus style face down on the ground. So you slip on a banana, I say, oh, let me warn him. Mm-hmm. So I send you a text that you get 10 seconds earlier. You're walking down the corridor and your phone buzzes. You pick it up, and it says, watch out for the banana peel.
Mm.
But now you're not looking where you're walking, and then you slip on the banana peel.
And you were the reason that it happened in the first place.
And I was the reason it happened in the first place.
Maybe you do stop me from doing that, but now you've changed the future, so you no longer need to send me that text message into the past, so that my past self doesn't get a text message.
Yeah, so what would happen is, in Back to the Future style, the text slowly disappears.
I know. And then for some reason, I slowly disappear. Neil, what have you done? That is interesting, because then it's the butterfly effect, where we've changed the timeline.
For all we know, we could be the rippled, different universe compared to what would have been. Mm-hmm. That's like the people who say, if this one thing didn't happen to George Washington, or to Napoleon, or to Hitler, then all the world would have been different. And I'm thinking, okay, I think you're overcrediting this one moment, mm-hmm. this one incident. They're losing track of the fact that certain forces that are operating to send culture, civilization in a particular direction, may be robust to certain changes you might make that you think will make all the difference. If Louis Pasteur had not accidentally found penicillin, then millions of people would have died after. No, you know, Betty Lou would have found penicillin a year later. So you pivot everything on this one thing and tell me that all of civilization would be different. I'm not buying it. Civilization is more robust than that. And if Hitler were killed as a child, then no, maybe not. The Germans were ripe to have somebody rise up and take control of their psyche. And maybe the circumstances made Hitler, not Hitler making the circumstances. So that's why you're worried that all of the butterfly effect will somehow veer it this way, rather than just be a slightly different thing, but in the same overall...
Of all these kind of things we've talked about, the butterfly effect seems like the most realistic. Where it is, it's not something that we can really quantify, but we can say that, as you were saying, everything happens, like there's always different changes that just ripple throughout history or what is going to be now future history.
And I'm saying, if it's not this butterfly, it was another butterfly. There's an article in the Journal of Irreproducible Results. It's where scientists who want to take the weekend off from their regular job think up some crazy scientific theory that is just completely stupid, but is scientifically justified. So there's an article that says, we have captured the actual butterfly that caused Hurricane Hugo, and it's right here. I think, in the end, I agree with Stephen Hawking, that we will discover a new law of physics that will prevent backwards time travel. And we don't know what that law is or why it must exist, but everything we can imagine that allows it totally messes everything up. You see the protesters in the street, you know, with the chant, what do we want? A time machine. When do we want it? Well, it doesn't matter. Anytime would be fine. So you can make the argument that if a time machine is ever invented in the future, there's no evidence of it having manifested in our past. Mm-hmm. But it shouldn't stop us from thinking about it in fun ways and thinking about living in this fixed life that's always being born, always living out, and always dying. I'd actually take some comfort in that. But it asserts that your life is predetermined. Mm. Even if it is, being a prisoner of the present, transitioning from the past to the future, I have the illusion of free will. Mm-hmm. And I'm happy to live in that illusion than in the knowledge that I don't.
Thinking about time travel, when it comes to kind of predestination or things are predetermined in your life, this path that you lead, time travel kind of makes it so that it is, everything is predetermined.
Mm-hmm, that's right.
There's no way to veer off this path. Everything you do was, if I go and go into a time machine, everything was leading up to that moment.
Yep.
Past me will then go and go into the time machine.
Yep.
And it'll just keep happening forever. Well, thank you, and also, speaking of time, you should take some time and go check out StarTalk Radio. There's a link down in the description, or there'll be something popping up probably right between our heads.
A link somewhere in
somewhere
space.
Here in space and time.
StarTalk.
But thank you, Neil. Thank you so much.
Dude.
It was a pleasure.
Dude. And as always, thanks for watching.
Thanks for watching.